Very good. Well, Marco, thank you for joining me today. I appreciate you taking the time. And everyone, what I'd like to do is introduce Marco Nunez. He's the senior analyst with Essential Staff Care, and he is joining me today to talk about why benefits matter. So instead of me just going on, I'm going to turn it over to you and we'll just have a conversation. How does that sound?
I love that. I love that. And it's one of our favorite conversations here at ESC. And if I get too long-winded or anything, feel free just to throw up a hand or interrupt me or whatever.
Okay.
This is honestly one of our favorite topics because so much has changed with the inception of the ACA over the last several years, and especially for staffing companies. And it's been really fascinating for us to be part of this ride because we've really seen here at Ground Zero how an industry like staffing, with very unique parameters to the way that it operates, high turnover being one of the most important when we're talking about any kind of benefits.
Sure.
And to see how, without some of those things really being taken into account when the ACA was created, it's created a very interesting experience for a lot of staffing companies where they went from not really having to know much or offer benefits at all. Mm-hmm. Maybe they were offering, voluntary benefits like ours, but certainly not having to dive deep into the minimum value stuff and all that. And now all of a sudden over the last several years, they've been drinking from this fire hose. And we've also watched as there have been a lot of unintentional consequences of the ACA. And I think that maybe that's one of the disclaimers I want to give up top is I always, whenever I talk about this, want to make sure people know that I'm really just offering an on the ground analysis of what mm-hmm. we've observed as the impact. There's no political agenda,
right.
In whether it's good or bad. There have certainly been some unintended consequences though. But before we really understand those, I think we first have to understand the reality for the average worker, certainly the average temporary worker. So a couple of stats just to throw out there real quick from various surveys over the last couple of years. One, we see that 78% of employees are living paycheck to paycheck. 68% report having less than $1,000 in savings. 56% of workers have less than $100 a month in discretionary income. Now, you take that reality, which is basically that the average worker is financially crunched. Mm-hmm. they've got enough coming in to really meet the bills, but any big emergency, financial emergency, is really going to cause a hiccup in their
sure.
kind of day in, day out machinery.
Right, right.
So then we look at what these unintended consequences of the ACA were and how they've shifted things. And then we really see why benefits are so much more important to temporary workers than ever before. So a couple of things that the ACA did, obviously it set this new kind of floor mm-hmm. for the minimum level of accepted benefits. And when we're talking about this, we're talking specifically about for an ACA compliant plan. So for a plan that satisfies the employer's mandate, if they're large enough, the ACA basically set this floor and said, if you are an employer of this size, you are going to have to offer at a minimum these kind of benefits in order for it to be an ACA compliant plan. Now, obviously, when you raise the level of benefits that must be offered, you're also putting upward pressure on the costs of right. that medical coverages. Now, the ACA then also, though, only allowed for a couple of different areas for that pressure, that cost pressure, to be released, right? Because at the end of the day, the math still has to work for the insurer. Right? Actuarial math is something that has been utilized for centuries now, and it's very precise, but there are a couple of things that you have to have. You have to have a long term, you have to have a lot of people, the larger the number that you can spread across risk and things like that, the better. And so the ACA only allowed a couple of areas for this price pressure. There's obviously pressure to keep prices down, because that's a big part of what the ACA was trying to do, is provide affordable, accessible coverage for people. But the only places that they really allowed for this pressure to be released, this upward pressure on cost to be released, was in the copay and in the cost sharing aspects of that.
Okay.
So as a result, what we see is the average deductible for a bronze level plan on the exchange in 2020 is, I'm just looking to make sure I have it right, is $6,506, according to the Kaiser Family Foundation.
Wow. Okay.
So the average, the lowest level plan that, you know, again, most hourly workers are probably going to be looking at, they're probably not going to be looking at the silver or gold level plan. Mm-hmm. They're going to be looking at that bronze level plan. The average one on the deductible that they have access to has a $6,500 deductible to it. Now, wow. Not only that, but because of the way the ACA was structured, it also allowed for the copay benefits to be stripped out in a lot of cases. So maybe you have a $30 or $50 doctor's visit copay, which means that, you know, you've got this $6,500 deductible, but if you go to a doctor's office, it's going to cost you whatever that copay benefit is. Sure. But in a lot of cases, especially in the staffing industry, in order to keep costs down, we're seeing plans that have, you know, a higher deductible, but then don't have any copay benefits. And then the out-of-pocket max was the other area where the ACA allowed for a little bit of that pressure to be taken out. So what that creates then is a situation where for the average worker today, if they're signing up for one of these kind of bronze level plans that we're talking about, you know, the average premium for a bronze level, the lowest level bronze plan on the exchange is around $300 for 2020, okay? So you've got an average premium about $300 a month, but let's say that this particular individual qualifies for the subsidy help, right? Mm-hmm. And so let's say that they only have, let's make it really low. Let's say they only have a $50 a month premium. If they're in one of these bronze plans that has a $6,500 deductible with it, chances are they're having to pay, in some cases, 100% of the costs up to that first $6,500. And then they're getting some kind of coinsurance kick in, an 80-20 split, 60-40 split on that next $1,000 or $1,500 up until the out-of-pocket max. The out-of-pocket max is typically around $1,500 more than that deductible level or so. I think it's capped at around $8,000 for 2021. So what that means for them is that even though they're signed up for this insurance, they're paying $50 a month, but they're paying $50 a month for the opportunity then to have to spend several thousand more dollars out of their pocket for any of those costs they incur. And again, maybe they have some kind of coinsurance in there where it's an 80-20 split where they're only paying a percentage of it. But the fact of the matter is that they're going to pay out eventually $6,500 out of their own pocket within that year. Now, if they do, one of the great things about the ACA is that once that deductible and then that out-of-pocket max is reached, well, now the insurer is on the hook for 100% of your claims for the rest of the year up to infinity. So that's a great thing. Mm-hmm. But I think for a lot of, especially hourly workers who are dealing with, you know, challenges with their day in, day out income, the idea of signing up for a plan that you then have to spend several thousand dollars out of your pocket for is not very appealing. And even the folks that do sign up for that as some kind of insurance against catastrophic loss,
right,
they're still not getting day-to-day help.
Right. Yeah. And I, you know, when you were talking at the beginning about, you know, most folks don't even have $1,000 in savings and they have maybe $100 of discretionary income every month, those numbers obviously don't work out. So right. Knowing all of that and kind of understanding how important it is for employers to offer, you know, benefits to at least, you know, help them somehow. Like where do they go from there? And then what can the employers be doing? Because obviously having benefits does attract quality employees. So I guess
absolutely.
Those, I know that's two separate questions, but kind of where do we go from here knowing all of that?
Yeah. Well, and to reinforce, you know, something that you just said, you know, some of the things that are coming out, MetLife does an annual employee benefits survey, and they actually did part of it before the pandemic shutdown and then part of it during and after. And what they found was that 80% of employees now believe that their employer is responsible in some part for their health and well-being. 67% of employees said having enough money to cover out-of-pocket medical costs is the top source of their financial stress, and 52% of employees are concerned about their financial health. So, I mean, it's stuff that's obvious given all the other stuff we just out there. So I think the first thing that I would say, especially for companies in the staffing industry, is just commit. Like, do the research and convince yourself that benefits are actually something that are increasingly important. Because that's the first thing that I've kind of noticed and been surprised of over the last, you know, couple years, is seeing various staffing companies' websites or their job ads and really realizing, wow, they're not really harnessing the power of the benefits that they're offering. They're not harnessing the impact of that and the importance of it to their audience. There's maybe, you know, a dot or two in a job thing, or on their website, they may say, we offer health benefits, but they're not really going into explaining it. And to me, that is evidence that they're just not bought into the fact that benefits really are that important and valuable to workers. So I think for me, it starts with, make that decision that you're going to look into benefits and decide for yourself. And if you see the information I've seen, you're going to be convinced that, oh, this is actually something that can really help us recruit and retain the top talent in our marketplace, because more and more people, especially after the pandemic, are aware of their need for some kind of, mm-hmm. of benefits in this area.
Right.
And then the other thing is, be creative and really look to make sure that the benefits you're offering are valuable and usable. Okay. And there's a whole spectrum of those, from the voluntary benefits, like our essential staff care fixed indemnity plan, which allows us to provide some kind of income replacement benefit value, you know, at a very low accessible cost. There are lots of different types. Now, one thing that we always caution folks, there's a lot of talk today with millennials and things in particular that they like a lot of different choices. And so there's a move sometimes to say, well, just offer as many things as you can. And so mm-hmm. we'll see companies sometimes offering 20 different benefit options, everything from commuter benefits to pet insurance. Yeah. And there's a concept called the paradox of choice, where it's been shown scientifically that if you offer too many choices, it actually leads to decision paralysis.
Right. Yeah. So it's overwhelming. I get that. My husband and I, when we go to a restaurant, if the menu is too big, I don't know what I want. So I get
absolutely.
It. I get it.
That's that kind of decision paralysis of the paradox of choice.
Yeah. You know, you had said something too, and I wonder if it is that many of the staffing owners may not be aware of the statistics that you mentioned, and particularly the overwhelming number of employees now that look to their employers for, you know, some sort of a healthcare solution to help them with that in their life. And I guess for me, when I'm looking at this and saying, I figured that it was a fairly high number, but I had no idea that it was that big. And I get that I'm in a very privileged circumstance in that, you know, I get really great healthcare coverage from my employer, and the premiums are very reasonable, and I'm in a very different situation. So there's a lot of awareness that this just helps me understand. But to that point, what would you say then is a good way for staffing owners, when you're looking at their website and you say, well, we offer benefits, what's a good way for them to use that as a good hook on their website and to be talking about it with employees to use it as a differentiator?
That's a great question. I think maybe the easiest way that I could answer that is to say, really focus on the value you're mm-hmm. providing and not just the raw benefit, because a lot of times it's just kind of a checkbox, like, hey, make sure that, you know, we have 401k. But I think in this area, it really needs to help them understand the value. You know, this is a benefit that's going to provide you coverage on basic day-to-day medical needs, or this is something that's going to, you know, if you live in a state that still has a state individual mandate, you know, this is a plan that's going to help meet your state individual mandate obligation.
Right.
Whatever the kind of specific value that really, you know, they're going to experience in their day-to-day life. Obviously making sure that it's affordable and accessible for them. But really it does start with making that decision, first of all, that you are going to really focus on expressing the value you're providing through your benefits. And then, you know, obviously prior to that, making sure that you're selecting and offering benefits that are actually offering value. And like we talked about at the beginning, what that really means for the average hourly worker, especially, is stuff that's going to help them with their day-to-day medical needs. Because again, the ACA has done a great job in providing this umbrella of protection for folks, especially at lower income levels, for catastrophic things.
Right.
But because of some of these unintended consequences of the way that this massive, you know, legislation was put together, there is a segment of, you know, of the workforce population that's kind of being left behind right now and not really being serviced very well at the ground level with this stuff.
And I would suspect that when an owner is looking at the different programs that are available, it will mean different things to different sectors, meaning someone who is focused on light industrial is probably going to have a different review process and try to understand the value proposition to their temporary employees versus someone who's in medical or someone who's in IT, right?
Absolutely. Yeah. Yeah. And that really is that, you know, making sure that what you're offering is of value to your particular mm-hmm. workforce and really right. understanding where they're at and what their experience is. Cause you're right. Because some of the higher level, the more professional, levels of staffing, they're actually in a position to be able to look at some of these more robust minimum value ACA compliant plans. Mm-hmm. Because you're able to make the costs work out a lot differently than when you're dealing with somebody who's, making
sure.
$10-$15 an hour.
So, and of course you said, first of all, you need to, as an owner, decide this is something I'm going to do. And then mm-hmm. the next step is really, okay, I need to understand my employees and really what's mm-hmm. important to them and kind of the things that they're faced with and what they have to deal mm-hmm. with day in and day out. And from there, you've got to overlay those things to say, here are my options. And of course, that can be daunting in and of itself mm-hmm. if they don't have a partner like Essential Staff Care to at least talk to say, what are my options and what do these options mean? So yes. Would you say that an owner, when they're going through a review like this, like, is that really kind of the process that they'll go through, of course, committing, understanding their employees and what they really need, and then saying, here are my options, and kind of funneling down to, here's a couple of things that really make the most sense. Is that kind of like the most logical approach?
Absolutely. Yep. Yeah. Okay. And like you said before, I think the better equipped they are with an understanding of who exactly their workforce is and what their current needs mm-hmm. or challenges are around areas like benefits,
sure.
then I think, obviously the better and more focused you can be in finding those right solutions for them. But yeah, that's perfect.
Yeah. And I'm sure that this, any owner listening to this could be sitting there saying to themselves, yeah, this all makes sense, but how do I get that data from my constituents and understand mm-hmm. what my people want to see? What have you seen some owners do to get that kind of input or feedback from their employees to help them make a decision like this?
Hmm. Well, I think it's easy. We primarily focus on the kind of, light industrial segment.
Mm-hmm.
And in some cases, some of those higher, more professional segments as well. But what we've created and what we've designed is really meant for those kind of day-to-day hourly workers. And so in those situations, it's a little easier to look at the demographics and look at the kind of data that's out there from just general surveys and go, okay, this clearly is going to fit our population and this describes, if the average worker out there is having this issue, then obviously our segment of that is going to have an issue with that as well. And I think from there, there's all kinds of survey technologies that you can utilize where, you can get that information out. Obviously, mm-hmm. if folks are coming in, you can ask those questions
sure.
When they're onboarding or when you're having those initial conversations with them.
Sure.
Again, there are plenty of tools where you can just send out quick, easy surveys to your folks as well, asking them to provide.
Yeah, that's a really good point, Marco, because I would see that being invaluable when you're onboarding people to just say, these are two questions we're going to ask them. And mm-hmm. Gain some information that way. And I know there's SurveyMonkey and a number of things that they can send mm-hmm. out to the employees to try to gather some of that information. So I think that's invaluable as well.
Efficient.
Go ahead. Yeah, go ahead.
Well, I was going to say, pretty efficient too. Like you were saying, if you've got it set up where as part of your onboarding process, you ask everybody these two questions, over time with the large volume of folks that the average staffing company is onboarding,
right.
That gives them a large base of information and data set to deal with.
Yeah. And then I would have to say to your point earlier, there's got to be a commitment to, okay, now we've got this information. What are we going to do with it? How long are we going to collect it before we make this decision? and kind of take it from there. But from my perspective, you know, one of the things that I didn't mention when we first started talking is that, you know, we have a longstanding relationship with Essential Staff Care. There's a reason for that. You know, we trust you. We send a lot of our clients to you. And I would highly encourage anyone who has questions to either connect with you on LinkedIn or any one of the team at Essential Staff Care, for if nothing else, no other reason to just kind of guide them through, here are some things to be taking a look at and here's what's important. But I appreciate you taking the time. I think this was really valuable. I think it's sometimes nice to step back and just say, okay, I got to take a deep breath. I know this is something I need to do, but what are some things I need to look at? And with that said, any parting advice that you would want to share or suggestions that you think are important for people to know?
I think maybe the last thing I'd say, you know, we talked a lot about making sure that you're focused on your employees' needs and what they're looking for out of this. And that's absolutely the most important starting point, especially if you're doing this to increase your recruiting and retention abilities. But there are kind of back office considerations as well.
Sure.
You know, and those are how easy it is to administrate the benefit. You know, and one of the things I would say in that is, you know, if you can, make sure that you're going with a benefit provider that is integrated in with the solutions that you're already using, which is, again, why we have a relationship and a partnership with Tricom.
Right.
Because that just brings value to everyone. Your clients, our clients, everybody benefits out of that process when the process is built together and more seamless. And obviously, we're only and you're only connecting with partners that are like-minded and mm-hmm. share your commitment and right. your values and the way that right. you treat those employees. So that's an important part of it as well, is, you know, making sure that as an employer, that you're stepping into a process that's going to be easy for you to navigate.
Right.
Function with.
Yeah, I think that's really good advice. So anyone who's watching this, you know, my two, maybe three key takeaways are absolutely, if this is something that you're going to do, commit to it and determine the information that's going to be beneficial to you to make this decision. But more importantly, once you have committed to it, or maybe you already have and you're just not utilizing it as a differentiator, mm-hmm. make sure that you are really understanding the impact of the employees and putting that out on your website and talking mm-hmm. about it during the onboarding process, because I think it's, again, it's just another way for you to show how much you care about the people that are working for you.
Yes.
And we all know, especially now, everybody mm-hmm. wants to know that they're cared for, that there's some kindness in the world. And if you're able to articulate to your employees, hey, this is the benefit, and we've seen from past experiences, this is what it does for our employees, that speaks volumes. And it takes you a couple of extra minutes, but it's a huge differentiator. So definitely agree with that. And of course, to your point, look for whatever partners you can that are working together that can kind of help you with this process. And of course, we Absolutely. Are integrated with you guys, and it makes it easier for our clients. But
yeah.
I encourage everyone who's watching this, connect with Marco. He's clearly a great resource for you. And certainly if there's someone else within the organization, he would get you there. But I thank you so much for your time today.
Absolutely.
This has been
Shelley,
wonderful.
Thank you so much for your time as well.
Absolutely. And let's stay connected, okay?
Absolutely.
All right. You have a great day. Thanks, Marco.
You too, Shelley. Thank you. I think that was great.